So far in our look at chemical weapons, we've taken a look at what are chemical weapons, and we've also taken a look at blistering agents. In this video, we're going to take a look at the most dangerous, the most deadly of all chemical weapons, and those are nerve agents. So what are nerve agents? These are extremely dangerous. These are the most toxic and rapidly acting of all of the chemical weapons. These things can cause death within minutes after exposure. They are typically liquid under temperate conditions. When you disperse them, the more volatile ones are in vapor form as well as a liquid hazard. Others that are less volatile are primary a liquid hazard. So these things can either be vapor or liquid. You can disperse these, meaning you can send them out, you can kick them out, you can attack with them by a ton of different ways. You can use missiles, you can use rockets, you can launch heavy artillery, for example, howitzer shells, you can bomb, you can use the spray tank for them, you can put them in landmines, and just anything that you can think of to get the chemical weapon out there, nerve agents can be dispersed in that manner. These things can get into the body by the lungs, meaning you're breathing them in, or by skin contact. So what do? Well, nerve agents are called nerve agents because they impact the nervous system. Now, we're not going to get too much into the functions of the nervous system in this video. If you're more curious about the nervous system, be sure to check out our anatomy and physiology videos on the nervous system. So let's keep this kind of simple as an explanation. What occurs here is the nerve agents are going to impact something called acetylcholinesterase. What this does is acetylcholinesterase is going to break down acetylcholine. I know what you're thinking. You're like, yeah, I thought you were going to keep this kind of simple. Here we go. Acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter. A neurotransmitter is how information is sent from neuron to neuron, or neuron to muscles, or neuron to organs. And I'm oversimplifying some of this. But acetylcholine is a neurotransmitter. It generally stimulates things. So for example, I'm going to raise my hand, and what's happening here is my brain is telling my hand to raise. It is sending nervous impulses via neurotransmitters, acetylcholine, to the muscles of the arm and the hand. Now, once the nerve impulse has been sent, we want to get rid of the chemical that sent the information. That's where acetylcholinesterase comes in. If we don't make the acetylcholinesterase, we can't break down the acetylcholine, which causes the acetylcholine to just keep sending information. It keeps sending that same signal, and it builds up, and it builds up, and it builds up until overload. So what a nerve agent does is it keeps the body from relaxing. It keeps the body from breaking down signal information once it's been sent. So overstimulation. Some of the signs and symptoms of a nerve agent, now this kind of makes sense if you keep in mind what it actually does at the physiological level, if you keep in mind what it does at the cellular level, at the neurotransmitter level, okay? So what a nerve agent does, some of the signs and symptoms are rhinorrhea. This is one of the early signs of possible impact, of possible exposure. Rhinorrhea is a medical term, a $10 word, for a runny nose. Other signs and symptoms could be nausea, you don't want to throw up, weakness, possible convulsions, spasms. At higher concentration, loss of muscle control, nervous system control, system irregularities, and death may occur. The actions of the nerve agent can be irreversible if victims are not treated quickly. So where do these nasty things come from? First of all, nerve agents are not found in nature. These things have to be man-made. They are made in manufacturing, in labs. They have to be isolated for high purity and toxicity. In other words, they have to be isolated in order to really be effective as a killing agent. Most nerve agents belong to a chemical group called organophosphates. Now, organophosphates are not necessarily a bad thing. In fact, many insecticides, things that we kill insects with, or herbicides, things that we kill weeds and plants that we don't want are based on organophosphates, and unfortunately, so are nerve agents. Organophosphates is the core of a lot of these nerve agents. Now, the stuff that you find in insecticides and herbicides aren't exactly nerve agents that we're talking about. They're not the nerve gas weapons that we're talking about. These are less potent. The nerve gases, the nerve agents, are again synthesized, purified, primarily to be used as a weapon. They're weaponized. So every industrialized country who has agriculture has the means of producing organophosphates. It's that next step into making it a weaponized version that causes the problem. TABUM, or GA, was the very first nerve agent, and it was discovered by accident back in 1936 by a German researcher. So what he was doing is he was looking for a new type of pesticide that would attack the insect in their nervous system. What he discovered was the very first nerve agent, the very first nerve gas.
GA was the first to be developed. Unlike the others, it has a faint odor, something like fruity chewing gum. It would probably be encountered in the form of a non-persistent vapor or aerosol.
Following this discovery, a series of nerve agents similar to TABUM were developed, and they were called the G series, G for German. Not to be outdone, in the late 1940s, another series of nerve agents was discovered by the British. This was also by accident. What wound up happening is somebody was developing another herbicide pesticide, and they were like, ooh, this is different, and they were sent to military researchers in the British military, and they were like, this could be used as a nerve gas, a nerve agent. So again, this was discovered by accident. The V series, the V stands for various things depending on who you read. It could stand for victory, venomous, or what have you. This series, the V series, includes the very deadly VX.
V agents are also odorless. The most important difference, however, is their slow rate of evaporation. Although a V agent may be used as a vapor or aerosol, it is most likely to be encountered as a liquid contaminant, producing casualties by contact as well as by inhalation.
Of the nerve agents, VX is the most deadly, and TABUM is the least deadly. Not that you want to be exposed to either one, but VX is the deadliest. Now, before we go, no conversation can be complete about nerve agents without talking about sarin, or otherwise known as GB. Sarin is a colorless, odorless, tasteless, human-made chemical weapon. It was originally developed in Germany in the 1930s as a pesticide. It is very toxic in both a liquid and a vapor state. It mixes very easily with water, and since it's odorless and tasteless, people could drink this and not even be aware that they're being poisoned. It can also be used to contaminate food. Again, odorless and tasteless, the person would not know that they're being impacted. They wouldn't know that they are being poisoned. Sarin is the most volatile of the nerve agents. It can easily and quickly evaporate from a liquid into a vapor. This will help spread throughout the environment. Sarin goes very quickly from a liquid to a gas. This is important when we start talking about the historical context of the sarin. A person can be exposed to the vapor even if they don't come in contact with the liquid. So for example, even if you're not in contact with liquid, you can still be impacted by the vapor. Maybe it's on somebody's clothing and you can still breathe that vapor in. Now, the good part about this, if there is a good part, is that because it evaporates so quickly, it poses a very immediate threat, but it's a very short-lived threat. So if somebody attacks with this, it's not going to still be dangerous months later, weeks later, years later. Now, when we start talking about other types of chemical, biological, radiological, nuclear weapons, for example, anthrax, a biological weapon, can stay dormant for infinity and come to life when it's ready to go kill something. So sarin, deadly in the short term, it will become dormant as time goes by. Sarin has a very interesting historical use. In the 1980s, Iraq used sarin against Iran in their war. In 1994-1995, Aum Shinrikyo, a Japanese religious sect, used bags of sarin liquid, poked holes in them on subways, and impacted commuters. So that is an example of the liquid turning into a gas. So Amsterdam Rico used sarin in the subway attacks of 94 and 95. In May of 2004, the presence of sarin was detected in the debris of a bomb that exploded in Iraq. And of course, the most recent example of sarin is what we're seeing right now in Syria with the chemical weapon mess that they have out there. So how do you know if you've been attacked by sarin? What are the signs and symptoms?
The symptoms of nerve agent poisoning are running nose, tightness in chest, dimness of vision, difficulty in breathing, drooling and sweating, nausea, vomiting, cramps, twitching, jerking, staggering, headache, confusion, drowsiness, coma, convulsions, cessation of breathing.
The first sign of sarin exposure are a runny nose, just like the other nerve agents, tightness in the chest, pinpoint pupils, your eyes get really tiny, okay, the pupil, the black opening gets really small, and eye pain. Victims will then experience drooling, sweating, coughing, chest pain, diarrhea, increased urination, confusion, drowsiness, weakness, headache, nausea, and vomiting. And of course, extremely large doses of sarin will result in loss of consciousness, involuntary twitching, jerking, paralysis, coma, and eventually death. Now, there is some good in all of this, and that is sarin does have an antidote. Sarin poisoning can be treated, but time is essential. If the person is hit with sarin, if the person is exposed to sarin, they can be saved, but again, timing is everything. They have to be treated immediately. Clothing, get rid of them. Clothing can retain the sarin, so it has to be removed. The victim should be taken to an open area as quickly as possible. They need to be put in a place where they can get fresh air as soon as possible. And as quickly as possible, the victim should also thoroughly wash themselves with soap and water. I read a case study on Amsterdam Rico, and it was interesting, sad, but also interesting, that a lot of the first responders also received sarin poisoning because the victims still had it on their clothing. And so through training, they figured out how not to do that again. That's going to conclude our discussion of nerve agents. We still have choking agents, blood agents, and incapacitating agents to look at. These videos will be available exclusively at MrFordsClass.net. Your membership is what allows us to make these videos. So until we start talking about choking agents, see you later.